Nailed it. Christian marriage is a joyful covenanting between a man and a woman in which they proclaim before God and human witnesses their commitment to live together in spiritual, physical, and material unity. In this covenant, they acknowledge the great love God has shown for each of them enables them to love each other. They affirm that God's gracious presence and abiding power are needed for them to keep their vows, to continue to live in love, and to be faithful servants of Christ in this world. For human commitment is fragile and human love imperfect, but the promise of God is eternal, and the love of God can bring our love to perfection. You may be seated. Well, let me, on behalf of Keaton and Kate, as well as their families, welcome you to this wedding celebration. In the spirit of the party that this day is, and it is a party, the families would like to welcome you to a dinner and celebration right here following the ceremony. Feel free to dismiss yourselves after the ceremony itself. Please join me in asking God's hand upon this day and their lives together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, today we thank you for bringing Keaton and Kate together. God, we ask that you would fulfill them as they begin their married life together as one. And as much as we want to make this day memorable, Father, we look forward to when we can celebrate their 10, 20, even 50-year anniversary. God, between now and then, will you provide Keaton and Kate with the love, sacrifice, intimacy, forgiveness, and patience that is needed to sustain their relationship through the years? Do this so that you might be honored and they might be fulfilled. Amen. Well, this wedding is a celebration of the gift of love God has given to Keaton and Kate for one another. Every one of us was created by God to enjoy all of our relationships. The most important relationship we have, and the one that satisfies the deepest needs of our heart, is our relationship with God. And so to make this worship relationship priority number one in Keaton and Kate's marriage, they would invite you to join them as they sing a song of worship to the one who fulfills us in ways no human being can or should be expected to. One song that reflects the values the couple has for their marriage. So if you are willing and able, please stand and join them in song.
Should nothing of our efforts stand? And should nothing of our efforts stand? No legacy survive unless the Lord does raise the house in vain. It's we'll sing, all glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing, all glory be to Christ. When on the day, the great I am, the faithful and the true, the Lamb who was for sinners slain, is making all things new. Behold, our God shall live with us and be our steadfast life. His rule and reign will ever sing, all glory be to Christ.
Our scripture reading today is from Genesis 2, 18 through 25. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called them, every living creature, that was his name. The man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon him. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from him, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed.
Well, you made it, friends. After months of dating, planning, well, years of dating for you guys, decision-making, scheduling, you're finally here. In a matter of minutes, not weeks, days, not even hours, but in a matter of minutes, the two of you are going to walk down that aisle right behind you, and you're going to be married. Before you get there, I want you to just take a moment to soak it all in. Turn here and look up at your friends that are here with you. Now turn and look at this crowd that likes you a lot. They drove far and wide to see this event today. Now I want you to turn and look at each other just for a moment. This day has already been a blur in many ways. Take a deep breath again, recognizing the gift that all of this is. Kate, I need you to look at Keaton one more time because this is the best he's ever going to look. I mean, seriously, look at that green. Come on. So good. But Keaton, if marriage has taught me anything, it's that your wife will get more beautiful with each passing day. Actually, you should repeat that after me real quick. My wife will get more beautiful. Perfect. That's just one of the many ways you're marrying up today, my friend. This is a big moment, a special moment, an expensive moment, but a moment you will never forget. You both are about to enter into the most unique and intimate relationship God has ever invented, that of marriage. And before I say anything else, I want to tell you both, it's been a gift getting to know you both more over this past year, especially. Thank you for sharing with me and Emma, my wife, about your dating relationship, about the families you grew up in, and now your engagement. I also want to thank you both for your willingness to be open and honest with me and take our time together seriously. If you continue to give your marriage the time, reflection, and attention that you did during our times together, you will experience marriage as God intended. This message is going to have two parts. First, I want to encourage Kate and Keaton, and then I want to address those of you who have come to witness this ceremony today. Keaton and Kate, on the first day of your new lives together, I want us to consider what it means to put on love, a phrase I'm borrowing from the New Testament. Specifically, what is the love we're supposed to be putting on, and how do we do it? Because if there's one word we have a hard time really nailing down as a society, it's this word love. What we do know from our experiences is that human love is fragile. It's often easier to be self-seeking, stubborn, petty, and impatient than it is to love. But when you really want to understand something, and knowing Keaton, your analytical mind and your teaching background, I think we can agree it's appropriate to go to the expert, to go to the source. So as we consider what it means to put on love today, we ought to not start with our understanding of love, but instead we start with God, who made us, and therefore he gets to define love on his terms. And there are two descriptions that I think tower above the rest, especially as we encounter God in the first half of the story. The first is that love is powerful. Hear these words from a wife to her husband in the book of Song of Solomon. It says this: love is as strong as death. Its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love, neither can floods drown it. If a man offered for love all the wealth of his house, he would be utterly despised. Crazy. In short, love's power is beyond measure. Even death, this thing that comes for all of us, can't hold a candle to love. It can't be bought and it can't be extinguished. Love, according to God, is exceedingly powerful. That's the first thing. The second thing is that love is lasting. The most consistent principle or picture in the Bible of love is the description of God making and sticking to vows. Quite similar to what you guys are doing here today. God's vow is called a covenant, and it operates different than a contract. A contract is time-bound, and it says, you do this, and I do that. If you don't uphold your end of the bargain, I have legal rights to scram. But a covenant isn't about give and take. A covenant doesn't come with conditions that need to be met, but instead fights for the lasting, ultimate good of the other, regardless of merit, regardless of offense. The covenant God makes is about how he will always move towards his people, demonstrating that no matter what happens, he will always protect and care for them. One of my favorite descriptions of this covenant that God makes is offered in the Old Testament by a man named Jeremiah. He says this: God's covenant is an everlasting love that draws us in with unfailing kindness. I want you to both consider that today for a moment. The covenant you are making here is a picture of a love that lasts forever and draws the other in with kindness that never fails or wavers. It never harms. From generation to generation, God fulfills his vows to care for, protect, and move towards his people. His love is perfect, and it never short circuits. It always delivers. But our experiences in this life, and the Bible as well, consistently show us that things simply aren't the way they're supposed to be. And we regularly don't see or experience the powerful, lasting reality of God's love. In fact, many, if not all of us here today, would say we don't have or we don't even know of a single relationship that always draws us in with an unfailing kindness. Instead, our affections are usually conditional. We love people more when they are affirming us and meeting our needs, and we often hold back in order to protect ourselves from getting hurt. Our experience of love regularly doesn't measure up to what it ought to be. In fact, one of my favorite authors puts it in these terms. He says, all of us have a lifelong nostalgia, a longing to be reunited with something in the universe from which we now feel cut off, to be on the inside of some door which we have always seen from the outside. I love that. Although God's powerful, lasting love does in fact rest at the very heart of reality, we sense that we've been somehow cut off, and we have a deep longing to be reunited to it. All of us have this feeling in some form because it is in fact true. Our real situation is that we have been cut off, separated from that perfect love. But fortunately, the story doesn't end there, because in addition to God's love being powerful and lasting, the clearest, even loudest description we have of love, the love that God gives, is that love is costly. In order to bring us back into the love that we've all been separated from, God paid the infinite price, the price of his son, who took on our separation so that we could be brought near. This brings us to the very center of how we understand love. This is how we know what love is, that Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. Love came down from heaven in the form of a person to take our lovelessness onto himself and die in order to reunite us back to the very heart of reality, to bring us to the inside of the door which we have always seen from the outside, to bring us to God, the author of love. To put on love, then, is not first about being nice or practicing better listening skills. But Keaton, it's always good to practice as a husband, just saying. But first and foremost, it is about receiving the love of another, receiving the sacrificial, costly love of Jesus. Kate and Keaton, your relationship as husband and wife is ultimately designed to put on this love and demonstrate to us the rich, intimate relationship between Jesus and his bride, the church, to show us the powerful, lasting, costly love of God that leads to celebration, just like what we have pictured here today. In fact, in many ways, we have a better understanding of the gospel or the good news of Jesus as we all witness your wedding. In the midst of economic uncertainty, a rise in violence in our cities, a spike in anxiety and loneliness, all during a global pandemic, today we're here and we're celebrating in a forest. What a gift. The two of you today are showing us this love that's been given to us in Jesus, how the love of Jesus interrupts our sorrows, how he gives us gifts despite ourselves, and how he replaces our tears with laughter, joy, food, and maybe some dancing. There might be some dancing. We'll see. This celebration is a picture of the eternal banquet that is to come, and your job as husband and wife is to help us taste it. So I charge you both, as the scriptures say, to put on love, the greatest love, that of Jesus, who laid down his life for you. Your call, Keaton, is to lead and to love your wife. Your bar is exceedingly high. You are called to demonstrate to Kate the same love that Christ showed his church by laying down your life and your preferences, to love at great cost to yourself, and to ultimately die metaphorically every day and literally should the situation present itself. Put on God's great love for you as you move toward and pursue your bride. Kate, you too are called to put on love, to be Keaton's biggest fan in a world that will beat him down. Show him that he is genuinely significant. Rather than master his flaws, brag about him to your friends, even when he's not around. You now hold his heart in your hands in a way that no one can rival. So encourage and build him up. And in so doing, your marriage will thrive. Put on this love and expect God's grace to lead you in powerful ways. And now to those of you who are family and friends gathered here today to witness this wonderful event, I have two things to ask of you. First, I would ask you to encourage and support this couple. Marriage ain't easy. Call them, drop in on them, stay for days on end, find me after, I'll give you their address. And second, look at their marriage as a tiny slice of the whole pie of how God looks at you. Isaiah 62:5 says this, "As the groom rejoices over the bride, so too your God will rejoice over you." In the same way that we see Keaton rejoicing over Kate, God desires to rejoice over you. When you see the love they have for one another, this is a drop in the ocean compared to God's amazing love for you. And if you are questioning whether God is even there at all today, look at this marriage and this day as an awesome reminder of how much Jesus Christ loves you. Keaton and Kate, may you grow in your love for one another as you put on the love of Jesus. In so doing, God will be glorified. You will be fulfilled. And those who come into contact with you will experience a glimpse of God's great love for them. Amen. Well, Keaton and Kate, it is now time to state your marital intentions before God and to make lifelong promises and vows to each other among witnesses. Let's begin with your intentions. Keaton, do you take Kate to be your wife? And do you commit yourself to her to be responsible in the marriage relationship, to give yourself to her in love and work, to invite her fully into your being so that she can know who you are, to cherish her above all others and to respect her individuality, encouraging her to be herself and to grow in all that God intends?
I do.
Kate, do you take Keaton to be your husband? And do you commit yourself to him to be responsible in the marriage relationship, to give yourself to him in love and work, to invite him fully into your being so that he can know who you are, to cherish him above all others and to respect his individuality, encouraging him to be himself and to grow in all that God intends? You can hand the bouquet. You can turn towards each other, just like that. Perfect. Keaton and Kate, in front of these family and friends who have come to witness this event, we now come to the part of the ceremony that holds the greatest significance for you both, the vows. A vow is a sacred promise, a covenant meant to resemble God's promise to his people. Keaton, we will start with you. I'm going to do this without making a mistake, and there's going to be no feedback.
In the name of God, I, Keaton, take you, Kate, to be my wife, my life's partner. I vow to seek God's best for us to create a stable, loving, and godly family. I will love you in times of laughter and in times of tears, in times of good health and in times of bad. I choose to walk with you through our lives, enjoying and giving thanks for the things God has given us to share. By the grace of God, I vow that I will love you, be faithful to you, and be thankful for you as long as we both shall live.
In the name of God, I, Kate, take you, Keaton, to be my husband, my life's partner. I vow to seek God's best for us to create a stable, loving, and godly family. I will love you in times of laughter and in times of tears, in times of good health and in times of bad. I choose to walk with you through our lives, enjoying and giving thanks for things God has given us to share. By the grace of God, I vow that I will love you, be faithful to you, and be thankful for you as long as we both shall live.
Take the rings. Love it. The wedding ring is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual reality. May they be constant reminders to you both and all around you that you are marked, sealed, and bound with each other's love and promises of faithfulness. And just like this ring is a continuous circle without end, so may your love continue and your marriage be without end in this life. Keaton, repeat after me. I give you this ring as a symbol of my covenant with you, with all that I have and all that I am. I honor you. That wasn't even difficult. Nicely done. Kate, repeat after me. I give you this ring as a symbol of my covenant with you, with all that I have and all that I am. I honor you. The couple is now going to take communion together as their first act of marriage.
Thank you.
This is my body, broken for your healing. This is my blood, shed for me.
Keaton and Kate, you have declared your consent and vows before God and these people. May God confirm your covenant and fill you both with grace. Amen. Now that they have given themselves to each other by solemn vows, with the joining of hands and the giving of rings, by the power vested in me by the state of Minnesota and as a minister of the gospel, I declare them to be husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. What God has joined together, let no one separate. Keaton, you may now kiss the bride. It is now my distinct privilege to announce to you for the very first time anywhere in the universe, Mr. and Mrs. Keaton and Kate Shinn.